The joy of Christ brightens our lives. We give thanks for the light of love, bright and holy. The love of Christ comforts and challenges. Now let us light the Christ candle as we celebrate the birth of Jesus. Thank you, God, for your light in this world through Jesus Christ. The light shines in darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Amen. Let's stand and sing. May we joy to the world. The Lord has come. You sing it out. You know this.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let us receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature see, and heaven and nature see, and heaven and nature see. Joy to the earth, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy. No more let sins and sorrows roam, nor thorns and thistles groan. He comes to reign, his righteous throne. For as the curse is found, for as the curse is found, for as the curse is found. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love.
Well, Merry Christmas, everybody. Good to see you this morning. We had a wonderful crowd at their service last night. A good-looking group here this morning. Thank you for being with us. Welcome all of those who are watching online, wherever you are, under the covers and covered up because it's cold wherever you are. So we're glad to have you joining us for worship service this morning. I want to make a couple quick announcements to you. Ladies, your Bible study continues Tuesday at 10 o'clock in the community room. Men's Life is going to pick back up on January the 9th. That's a Monday afternoon at 2 o'clock in the community room. So we'll be picking back up our schedule after the first of the year. Last week we had a memory verse that we committed to us. As we looked at Matthew 2:10, when they saw the star, they rejoiced and with exceeding great joy. Inside your bulletin today, there's a memory verse for this week. Luke chapter 2 and verse 6, and so it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. Let's say that together. Luke 2:6. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. Aren't you glad that Jesus came to save us from our sins and to reconcile us back to God so we can walk with him and live with him every day? Let's get ready to worship the Lord this morning on this Christmas day and prepare our hearts and our minds to receive from him what he's prepared for us. Father, we're thankful today for the greatest gift that was ever given, which is the Son of God, Jesus Christ, come in the flesh and taking on our sins and dying on a cross, and then 3 days later being risen from the grave victorious over sin and death, giving to us the victory that he had. As Father, we commit ourselves to you, turn from our sins and repent, and trust in Christ as our Lord and Savior who has come to save us from our sins. And in doing so, Father, we enter into a right relationship with you, and we're grateful for that relationship today, that we can know you, that we can walk with you, and that we can live with you daily, and then for all of eternity. So, Father, today we come to rejoice in the fact that Jesus came, that first Christmas. We celebrate the Savior that was given. And today, Father, we give you our hearts and our minds to be open to receive from you the word that you have prepared for us, Father. Teach us about your love today. Help us to embrace that love and to walk in that love and to share that love with others. And so, Father, I pray that you would inhabit our praise. Give us a fresh awareness of your presence, for in this place, Father, at this moment, we are standing on holy ground as we meet with our Heavenly Father, sit at his feet, and glean from his word. So, Father, speak to our hearts today through the songs, be exalted, and through the message, Father, change our hearts and lives. We'll give you thanksgiving and praise for all of that. May this be the gift given to us this Christmas. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Praise him. Come lead us.
That's good singing, y'all. Continue. Good Christian men rejoice. Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Give ye heed to what we say. News, news, Jesus Christ is born today. Ox and ass before him bow, and he is in the manger now. Christ is born today, Christ is born today. Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye hear of endless bliss, joy, joy. Jesus Christ was born for this. He has opened heaven's door, and man is blessed forevermore. Christ was born for this. Christ was born for this. Good Christian men rejoice with heart, soul, and voice. Now ye need not fear the grave. Peace, peace, Jesus Christ was born to save. Calls you on and calls you all to gain his everlasting home. Christ was born to save. Christ was born to save. I heard the bells on Christmas Day their old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men. I thought as how the day had come, belfries of all Christendom had rolled along the unbroken song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And in despair I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Yet peal the bells more loud. God is not dead, or does he sleep? A wrong shall fail, the right prevail. With peace on earth, goodwill. Then ringing, singing on its way, the world revolved from night to day. A voice, a chime, a chant sublime, with peace on earth, goodwill to men. Scripture says, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened. Luke 2:15. Oh, come, all ye faithful.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Adore him. Oh, come, let us us adore. In Christ the Lord. Sing, choirs of angels, sing in exultation. Oh, sing, all ye bright hosts of heaven above. Glory to God, all glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him, Christ the Lord. Yea, Lord, we greet Thee, born this happy morning. Jesus, to Thee be all glory. Come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him, Christ the Lord.
Amen. Good singing. Be seated, would you?
Amen. If you got your Bibles this morning, I invite you to join me in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, as we read the Christmas story this morning. You follow along as I read to you Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. The census first took place while Cornelius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, betrothed to his wife, who was with child. So it was while they were there that the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. I read this week about a grandmother who took her four-year-old granddaughter to big church for the first time. The little girl sat in church, and she was quite attentive, taking in every aspect of the service, remained quiet, zoned in all the way through until the pastoral prayer. When the pastor began to pray, he said this. He said, "Thank you, Lord, for your presence." Her eyes popped wide open. She leaned over, jerked on her grandmother's sleeve, and she said, "Granny, are we getting presents today?" There is so much that comes at us at this time of year that distracts us. I mean, before you know it, Christmas Day is here. We haven't prepared ourselves, and we don't get to worship and celebrate that holiday, this high holiday of the Christian season, the coming of our Savior, the way that we wish that we had. The world's way of celebrating Christmas serves as quite a distraction. keeps us from enjoying the Lord's birth in spirit and in truth. There's so many things that they add to it and so many things that they take away from it. But one of the best ways for you and I as believers, as we've been unwrapping Christmas this year in this sermon series, one of the best ways for you and I to walk in and to enjoy the joys of Christmas is to discover and to embrace the love of God at Christmas time. Realizing the significance of what it meant for God to send forth His only Son, to be born in a manger, to grow up and take on our sins, and to die for us on a cross. If you really want to grasp the true joy of Christmas this season, we've got to understand that significance of God's love. How God loved us so much that He would do such a thing as this. Just what is the significance of how God loved us? Well, the Bible tells us in John 3:16 that God so loved the world. That's you and I. God so loved the world, every person in it. There's not an individual, whether you're watching online or you're here today, there's not a single person that God looks at and says, you know what, I don't really care for you. Every person, God so loved the world that He would send forth His Son and give His only Son that whoever believed upon Him would not perish but would have everlasting life. Now that's an interesting word, that believe. Everyone who believes upon Him, what does that mean? Well, it means to put complete trust. It means to have no doubt. It means to be certain of. If we were to apply that word to John 3:16 and to us, it would mean that we would have such a belief in Jesus Christ and all that He taught that He would that His life and His message would have a continual impact on our daily life. Every day our life would be impacted by what He taught and who He was and what He did for us. So through this message this morning, this Christmas message, I want to ask you to allow the Holy Spirit, if you will, to teach you today and help you find and trust in the love of God that is displayed through this Christmas season. We can find the expression of the love of God in the Christmas story. Somebody says, well, where is the love of God expressed in the Christmas story? I'm so glad you asked. There are three places that we see the love of God expressed in the Christmas story. The first one is, the love of God is seen in the condition of the world that Christ's birth was into. Listen, people have said that the most blessed individual that is touched by someone's love, they are most blessed when they understand the depth of the sacrifice or the gift of that love. Well, Jesus' birth was the creator of all things coming to His creation. We think about this. John tells us in the beginning, Jesus was the Word. He was with God and He was God, and all things were made by Him, and without Him, nothing was made. Paul tells us in Colossians, for by Him, talking about Jesus, all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authority, all things were created by Him and for Him. He is before all things, and in Him all things are held together. The writer of Hebrews tells us, did you know that very first Christmas began with a farewell in the heavenly dwelling place of God? In fact, the Hebrew writer writes this, he says that this, speaking of the Son to the Father, Jesus said, therefore, when I came into the world, He said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin you had no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I have come in the volume of the books written of me to do your will, O God. So that very first Christmas began with a farewell in heaven when God the Son said to God the Father, I'm going to leave heaven and I'm going to go to earth. And I'm going to take on a body there. And I'm going to become flesh, and I'm going to make my dwelling among men. That first Christmas was the Creator coming to His own creation. But when we think about that, this Jesus' birth, the Creator is coming to His own creation. But when He got here, when He came to this creation, it was not like the creation that He made. In fact, we look at this, and when God created everything, what did He say? The Bible in Genesis 1 tells us that when God created everything, after each day He said, now that was good. It was good. Everything was good that He made. The only thing that God ever said was not good was that man should not be alone. That's not good. But then He fixed that and He gave to him a helpmate. And then it was good. Everything that God made was good. It was right. It was perfect. But it didn't stay that way. We know just a Just three chapters into the Bible, we read where Adam sinned against God, and therefore the presence and the effect of sin was seen and felt on everything that ever existed from that point forward. And so, Jesus came into a broken world. Jesus' birth was a fulfillment of much biblical prophecy. And while you and I think about Christmas time, if you drive around this park or you drive around next door park over there, we think about Christmas time as a celebrative time, a time of lights, a time of festivities. But the fact of the matter is that the very first Christmas was a time, and Jesus' birth was a very dark time. It was a very dark time in this world. Just about 700 years prior to Jesus' birth, the prophet Isaiah wrote this. He said, "The light, who is Jesus, was coming into a world and to a people shrouded in darkness." You could use adjectives like gloom and anguish and contempt to describe the darkness that was found in this world when Jesus came. When Christ was born, the Word of God had not been heard for four centuries. That's 400 years. When you and I look at that blank page in our Bible, if you've ever done this before, if you come to the end of the Old Testament, the book of Malachi, and the first book of the New Testament, Matthew, if you look in between there, you'll find a blank page. You know what that blank page represents? It represents 400 years of God's silence. Not as inactivity, but 400 years of God's silence. When we look at this, the people of God were under oppressive rule of Rome. It's evident in the birth story of Jesus when Caesar Augustus requires a census to be taken and all people to be registered. This is the very thing, when he issued that, this is the very thing that brought Mary and Joseph, we know, to Bethlehem. The wicked emperor, Caesar Augustus, issues a decree of some kind for some kind of a census to be taken. And in doing so, he moves Mary and Joseph from Bethlehem, to where they are, to Bethlehem. And when we see this, we see that God even works in dark times. We see him taking something that the devil would try to use and use it for his own good. What a great reminder that is to us, that even when the devil thinks that he's got an upper hand in our life, he's still in the hands of God. You know, whatever, we've said this before, whatever you think of the devil, remember, he's still God's devil. And so God can even use him when he thinks he's getting away with something. God still can use him to accomplish his purpose. This is a time in Israel was a blatant reminder the people of Israel were not their own. They were owned by someone else. Herod was a descendant of Edom. And of Edom. Esau is the father of the Edomites. And they ruled in Jerusalem. According to who's who in the Bible, Esau represented the heart that is not serious about a relationship with God. He made frivolous decisions with irrevocable consequences. When Esau understood that it was unpleasing for his parents to marry certain women, he went out from certain tribes, he went out and found those women and married them and brought them home just to tick off his parents, basically. And he was a man of rebellion. The writer of Hebrews records this about him. He says, the Bible says, Esau lived a purposely rebellious life, and there was no place in his heart for repentance. Herod was like Esau. In this day of which Jesus came into the world, Herod was a man who lived only for self and rebellion to the truth. Even he ordered a massacre of innocent children in that vicinity and the surrounding vicinities because he was afraid, hearing the message that the king of the Jews, a new king of the Jews, a real king of the Jews, had been born, the Savior. He called him the Christ. And he was so intimidated by that and so infuriated by that, he ordered a massacre of all male children 2 years and under, so that he would make sure that the king of the Jews and the Savior of the world would not be able to live in advance. So the ruler of Israel was no longer God's man. It was no longer the perfect ruler that God had. He was a bad ruler appointed by men. Gone were the days of the Davidic kingship, and much like today, there were soldiers that roamed the streets and policed the streets. They weren't young Israelites with M16s, but they were Roman soldiers who policed the streets. And the promised land was no longer in the hands of Israel. It now belonged to a pagan power. The nation of Israel itself was fractured into four different segments of people, all struggling to have their own way and try to raise their own power. And the result of these four different competing groups of Judaism led to this constant friction, and only increased by the oppressive rule of the Romans. Riots were common. The tensions were certainly high. This is the world in which Jesus came into. Even the temple was no longer maintained by believers of the truth or people who understood the word or the will of God, but by servants that were governed by fear of the Roman oppressors. So we say, well, how can we see the love of God in Christmas? Well, we can see the love of God clearly by seeing that God sent his Son into this kind of world, into a broken world, into the conditions of this world. The light of the world was coming into a dark world. The world that he created was no longer the world that he created, but it was a broken world, desperately in need of redeeming, desperately in need of a Savior. And so he came. But secondly, we see the love of God is seen in the confrontations of Christ to this that he had in his world. John tells us a very interesting thing. He said he was in the world. The world was made through him, but the world did not know him. They didn't recognize him. They didn't respond to him. They didn't believe upon him. When you and I think about this, as we think back on that first Christmas, I want you to think back that even before Jesus was born, but the occasion rising up to his birth, think of all the different things that he encountered before he even came. Consider the harsh conditions of the travel. 100-mile journey was necessary leading to the birth of Christ. Living in Nazareth, Mary and Joseph lived more than 100 miles north of Bethlehem. And yet there was no way around it. Legally, they were required to make that 100-mile journey with Mary on the verge of delivery of her baby, as they were forced to do so. Listen, I want you to think about that for just a second. The devil uses an evil emperor filled with self-pride. He wants to know who's who and where they are for the purpose of taxation. So the devil uses this selfish ambition to get this couple, this young couple, on the verge of delivering, to have to travel 100 miles, and don't you know that the devil did all that he could to make this trip as hard as possible for this couple? Years ago, Max Lucado came out with produced an audio recording called A Cosmic Christmas. In that recording, it was a dramatization of how the angels and the demons fought for the persevering of that baby all the way on that journey. But what was dramatic was actually also real. Because the couple was forced to walk over hills and through streams and on a dark and dangerous journey. Now, we celebrate the pilgrimage today with festivities, but it was a dark and dangerous trek. Consider the harsh conditions of the cattle pen. Think about that for just a second. Not only do they have a long, dark, dangerous journey to get to where they were going, but when they arrive in Bethlehem, there's not even a place for them to stay. Not a place in town at all for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to be brought forth. The birth at Bethlehem is the most important birth to ever take place on earth. And the best place found for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords is in a place where the animals are kept. That's some confrontation. I want you to miss the significance of the humility of Christ. Being the King of the Jews, and he was worthy of being born in the best place that the world could offer for a baby to be born. But being last and the final high priest. They were only 6 miles from where the priests were. If the priests were even attuned to the Word of God or to what was happening, surely they could have found somebody, even a house, somebody in Bethlehem could have found a place for Mary to give birth to God's Messiah. Somebody wrote this, that if someone rich or influential had been supporting Mary and Joseph, a place certainly would have been found for them. But instead, Christ lowered himself to be born of a man, born as a man, taking on human flesh, being born into a stable or a cradle, a place where the animals are kept. And for 33 years, he walked among us, relating to us so that we could relate to him, knowing us, identifying with us. And 33 years later, he would take our sin upon himself and die on the cross for us. He showed his humility by being born of a lowly place, meant for animals, not for babies. Certainly not for a king. Consider the hard conditions of Herod's heart. We just talked about a moment ago when Herod heard what had happened, that the King of the Jews had been born, the Christ, he called him. He understood exactly who Jesus was. And when he had been born, he didn't go to worship him, but he set out to murder him instead. Consider the treatment and the confrontation from the religious leaders of his day. Jesus, at the age of 30, began a ministry. And as he began to his earthly ministry, he came preaching and teaching the Word of God. People were amazed at his teaching, but the Pharisees and the Sadducees had absolutely no clue what was going on, not only on the night of Christ's birth, but they did not recognize him or respond to him positively, even in his teaching ministry. They were no longer hungry for the spiritual truth of their day. So when Jesus came preaching and teaching, what did they do? Their response was to reject him and to plot to kill him. The sad truth of the matter is that, especially at Christmas time, men are still rejecting the truth and the message of love and hope that Christ brings. When we look at the Word of God, we consider that the Word of God tells us that the heart is desperately wicked. Above all things, it's cruel. Who can understand it? The Bible says, the Lord says, "I, the Lord, search the heart and examine the mind." The truth is, if mankind is left to themselves in this kind of a world, we would be doomed forever. There's no telling what we could accomplish in the negative if we will not let Christ rule and reign in our own hearts, but if we want to be in charge. The scary thing about that heart is that it's clearly against Christ. It's truly against the lordship of Jesus Christ. It makes a human mind think it's doing right when in truth it's doing wrong, constantly going contrary to the Word and the will of God. This heart brings justification in its actions. It causes us to make frivolous decisions. It can cause and produce irreversible consequences if left to itself. When we consider Jesus coming, the Bible says he came to his own, but his own did not receive him. The love of God is seen in the fact that Jesus was rejected and crucified by his own. Many people make the false accusation that the Romans crucified Jesus. No, they didn't. The Romans carried out the Jews' wish. It was Jesus' people that sent Jesus to the cross. The love of God is seen that even while men were rejecting Jesus and the love of God, Jesus still came. And the fact of the matter is that through him, God demonstrated a tremendous act of sacrificial love, that while we were yet sinners, he sent Christ to die for us. So not only can we see the love of God and the conditions that he came to and the confrontations that he went through, but I want you to know that we see the love of God is seen in Christ's conquering of sin and death that was brought upon his world. He didn't bring it upon his world, but sin brought it upon his world and it needed to be fixed. Jesus came to a broken world that needed to be fixed. And I want to tell you this morning that only Jesus can turn a heart around that is set against God. Only Jesus can fix the broken world. Only Jesus can fix the broken man or the broken woman. Only he can intervene and put a stop to the irreversible consequences of sin and rebellion. Now listen carefully as I read to you the proclamation of the birth of Jesus, beginning in verse 8 of Luke chapter 2. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angels a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.' So it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, 'Let us now go into Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us.' And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the sayings which was told them concerning this child. And all those that heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary, she kept all these things and pondered them in her heart." That's why he came. This is the description of exactly why Jesus came. A Savior has been born to you. Throughout the history of men, whether it's ancient history of Israel or the history of the world or even modern-day America, we have been looking for a Savior, Why do you think superhero movies are so popular these days? Because we want a hero. We want that deliverer. We're looking for a peacemaker. We're looking for somebody who will make right all the wrongs. We're looking for somebody who will make justice just again. And at just the right time, the exact right time, in God's time, in history, the Bible says that God, in an act of incredible love, sent forth His Son Jesus, our great Redeemer. But He didn't just send Jesus. He supernaturally made a way for anyone, for everyone, who has an ear, who has a hunger, who has a thirst, who has a desire to know about the things of God, to get the message that Christ has come. He still works supernatural today through the power of the Holy Spirit, through the power of His Word, drawing men and women who want to hear about the Lord, to draw them to Himself. He's still doing that today. The great news is that in the middle of a sin-sick world, in the middle of a broken world, in the middle of a world that was desperately in need of a Redeemer, Jesus' birth was announced. People who sought God and were looking for God understood the Messiah had come. God made sure that those seeking Him were aware that the Savior of the world had arrived. And even the Magi, remember we talked about the wise men, the Magi, last time we were together. Even they went to Jerusalem because they were thinking to themselves, well, surely this is a place, not Bethlehem. Surely He would be born in a place like Jerusalem. That would be a big city. That would be a much better place for a king to be born. But there they received a new and fresh vision, a spiritual one, birthed from God's Word, where they could find the Savior. So not only did God make it known, but He used those who responded to the truth of God's message to then spread the message, as we saw the shepherds did, and they carried it forth. But unfortunately, today, this Christmas, at Christmas, what are we finding? We're finding that there's a world that still is broken, that is still working against God. Lawsuits are brought against those who want to publicly express their faith in Christ in Christmas season. Instead of saying Merry Christmas, we got folks that want to say, hey, Happy Holidays, because we want to ignore or we want to remove or we want to replace Christ with something else at Christmas. Christians in public service are more and more attacked by the media and people today that would express their faith or prayer in Christ. Even the church, in the purity of the pulpit, is experiencing problems today, threatened by those who serve the church in a selfish manner. And the church is embracing, in many cases, the false teaching and false doctrine and giving in to the sway of the world. Hey, just make people happy, because you got to have people, so just make them happy. Don't teach the truth. The Bible speaks about something like that. It says there's coming a day when men will want to have you tickle their ears. God did not give us His Son because we were attractive. He didn't give us His Son because He wanted to make us happy. He didn't give us His Son because we were good. He didn't give us His Son because we make all the promises in the world. God, if You'll just do something for me, I'll do this for You. He didn't give us His Son for that reason. He doesn't give us eternal life because He can gain something from us. He gave us Jesus because He loves us. I read some material this week from a Jewish legend, and he was talking about the days of creation, and he said, suppose, that on the day of creation, that some angels were present, as God was talking about, let us make man in our image, and he said, let's just suppose that there was a certain angel there, and the angel was the angel of justice. He said, I wonder what he would say. Maybe he would say, don't create man, for all he'll do is have all kinds of wickedness against his fellow man. He'll be hard, cruel, dishonest, and unrighteous. He said, maybe if there was an angel of truth, I wonder what he would say. He might say, well, don't create man, for he will be full of falsehood and deceitfulness. So maybe there was the angel of holiness. What would he tell God? He might say, well, don't create mankind, for he will be impure in his heart and dishonor the name of God in Christ. But at the end of the deliberation, the character of God being love, I could see him saying to all of them, let us create man in our image. And when he sins and turns from the path of true righteousness and from truth and a hunger for holiness, I will gather him from out of the world and tenderly through love bring him back to myself. Well, that's exactly what he did in Jesus. Coming to his world, coming to a broken world, enduring confrontation from beginning to the end, yet in love, still coming, still demonstrating his love. Romans 5:8 proclaims this powerful truth. But God demonstrates his love for us in this: while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Now, I want you to think just for a second. Think back for just a moment to that place that Jesus was born. Because it has great significance. The symbolism of it has great significance. Think about, just for a second, an animal pen, whatever it was, whether it was a cave or whether it was a barn, you know, we don't know. But we submit that the animals were kept in a particular place, and however they were kept. If you've ever been to a barn, how many of you have ever been to a barn? You ever been to a barn? Hey, you walk into a barn and go, oh man, that smells great. No, when you go into a barn, you understand this is a stinky place, isn't it? It's unpleasing smells. That's the aroma that God smells of sin. Sin is a stinky smell. It's a repulsive smell, an unpleasing aroma to God. The Savior of the world was born into that kind of uncleanliness, so that he could one day take all that was unclean and make it clean again for all those who would believe. He so loved the world that he gave us his only begotten Son, so that anyone who would believe would not perish, but would have everlasting life. Isn't it amazing that God came to that kind of a scene? And that reassures us of one thing. I don't have to fix myself up. I don't have to clean myself up to come to God. God came to me to do that for me. Just as Christ was born in a stinky stable, the Holy Spirit then is born into the man or the woman who repents of their sins and trusts or believes upon Christ. And the heart of man then is often chasing after the heart of man that was often chasing after sinful acts and selfish wills and the lies of the devil, that unpleasing aroma to God that's lifted up every time we do that. Here we see the love of God expressed as God moves into that person, moves into that stinky soul, that stinky heart. And we see the expression of God as the Holy Spirit of Christ enters into that person and begins to transform their life. Romans 8:9 says the Holy Spirit is referred to as the Spirit of Christ. Jesus called him the Spirit of Truth. The Bible says that Christians, whatever you want to call them, the Holy Spirit will be known by the believer. The Christian will know him because he lives in him. God's amazing love is always demonstrated in action. It is never complacent. It is always continually working in the Christian. The Spirit of Christ dwelling in the believer, within the heart of the Christian, is what transforms us, changes us from that old stinky, sinful person who lived for self into one who now lives for and walks with the Lord. Listen to what Paul writes in Romans 8. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Holy Spirit, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who lives in you. The true mark. Somebody says, well, how do I know that I'm a Christian? How do I know that I'm a born-again Christian? The true mark of a born-again Christian and believer, a genuine Christian, is that he knows the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. The child of God who knows the love of God sent in their heart by Christ can say with the Apostle Paul, what Paul said. He said, I've been crucified with Christ. No longer I that live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Listen, the truths of today's message are very simple. Just as Christ was born into these dark conditions, a hostile world to God's work, the love of God can be revealed to any heart who wants to know it, who wants to hear it, who wants to receive it, and to believe upon it. To respond to God's love simply means to accept Christ, to believe upon Him as your Savior and Lord. Listen, why did Jesus come and die on a cross? He did it because the wages of sin is death. And if you paid that penalty, or I paid that penalty, that death would mean eternal separation from God. But Jesus paying that penalty instead of us, taking our penalty upon Himself, cleared us of any debt. And the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's what Paul tells us in his word. We put complete trust in Christ. What does it mean to believe that Jesus died for me? What does it mean to believe that Jesus can live in me? What does it mean to walk with God? It means to put complete trust in, to have no doubt about, to be certain about, that Jesus' coming was for the purpose of dying on your behalf, and to free you from sin's debt, to make you a child of God, and to begin to transform your life into the image of Christ. To receive means to believe. It means to have such a belief in Christ that how He lived and what He taught will have a continual effect on how you live. So this Christmas season, the Holy Spirit calls you and I to the exhortation of the Apostle Paul. Here's what Paul said. Examine yourself. Examine yourself to see if you are of the faith. Test yourselves. Ask yourself, do I know that I believe upon Jesus? Do I know that I have the Holy Spirit of Christ living in me? Do I know Him? And am I responding to Him? Paul says, examine yourself and see if you are of the faith. Do you know the Holy Spirit of Christ living in you today? God's love is available to anybody and everybody who is willing to believe by faith and receive that love today. For He came because He loved you. And if you believe, you will not perish, but you will have everlasting life. He has shown that love by giving us His one and only Son. So today, we celebrate our Savior who has come. But not just that He has come, but that He has come to save us, and He has come to live in us. Is that your faith today? Is that the Christmas you're celebrating today? Is that the love of God that you know is applied to you today? Well, Father, we come before You today, and we thank You for the greatest gift that was ever given, who is the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, come from heaven to earth to become flesh, make His dwelling among us, and then, Father, to lay His life down for us on our behalf. Lord, we love You this morning, and we know that You love us, and we know, Lord, that it is Your desire today for every person online and here in this room to know, to believe, and to walk in the love of God. So, Father, I ask You today, if today would be the day of salvation for some, make that day today. May the greatest gift that they ever receive be the gift of believing upon Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Not only for now, but for every day this going forward into eternity. If you're online or you're here today, I'm going to ask you a question this morning. Have you put your faith and trust in Christ? I'm not asking you, do you know about Jesus? I'm not asking you, have you ever heard the stories about Jesus? I'm not even asking you, do you believe the stories that you've read about Jesus? What I'm asking you this morning is, do you know him? Have you ever invited him to be your personal Savior? By telling him, Jesus, I believe, and I put my faith and trust in you. How do I do that? Simple. The Bible says we believe with our heart and with our mouth we make confession that Jesus is Lord. All those who call upon him, then he will save. You can do that right where you're seated this morning. Simply tell Jesus right now, right where you're at. Just call out to him and tell him, say, Jesus, I believe. I believe that you're the Son of God, come from heaven to earth. I believe that you did that to die on a cross for my sins, to be my Savior. I trust you today to be my Lord and Savior. Thank you for forgiving my sins. Thank you for giving me eternal life. I thank you for the Holy Spirit that you give to me, to live in me, so that I can know you and walk with you from this day forward into all of eternity. Friends, if you call upon Jesus today, there's no magic in the words. He knows the intent of your heart. Just call out to him and say, Jesus, I want to turn from my sin and trust in you. Whatever those words are, he knows what you're saying. And he was willing to save you today because he loves you that much. Father, thank you for the gift of Christmas, who is Christ, that you loved us so much that you sent your only Son for us. May we honor that gift by walking with you and living for you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, Merry Christmas to you. I hope that today that you are celebrating whatever the gifts that you received this Christmas. I hope today you're celebrating the greatest gift that was given to you, which is the love of God in Jesus Christ. His sacrifice for your sins, the Holy Spirit living in you to make you look like Jesus, walking in right fellowship and relationship with him. As you leave here today, you're going to be encountering people who are going to have all kinds of ideas about Christmas out there. Make sure that you share with them the truth, that Christmas is about the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Be Jesus to all those that you meet. Share Jesus with all those that you meet. And we'll see you back here next Sunday. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.
Stand and sing, baby. Oh, come on, you faithful.